that will make us to fall, anything that will make us to fail, anything that will make us to falter, anything that will not make us to see heaven, Father, we pray that the power of this world take them away from us this day. Give us the strength, the courage, the boldness, the discipline to follow you until the very end. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 Turn your Bible to the book of Matthew. I'm reading Matthew chapter 4. In Matthew chapter 4, I look at verse 3. Matthew chapter 4, verse 3. And when the tempter came to him, he said, "If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread." But he answered and said, It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." Look at the word in verse 3. And when the tempter came, this is to the very Son of God. This is to God who became man. This is to the creator of the heaven and the earth. But when the tempter came, it is if the tempter will come. When the tempter came to Jesus Christ, the very Son of God himself. The tempter will always come, and Jesus will always defeat. And Jesus will remain an overcomer. You will overcome.
Amen.
Revelation chapter 3. I read Revelation chapter 3, verse 5. Jesus himself now said in chapter 3, verse 5, "He that overcometh, Satan, he that overcomes sin, he that overcomes self, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels." You will overcome.
Amen.
You will overcome.
Amen.
All those who have ever lived for God and his righteousness here on earth have experienced temptation at one time or the other. Temptation is one of those terrible weapons that the devil, Satan himself, is using against believers. And through temptation, our false parents, Adam and Eve, they fell, disappointed God, made a shipwreck of their faith at that time. And it brought humanity into trouble. The consequence of the fall, has brought suffering, has brought death, has brought calamities to the human race. Satan also tried to beguile, to tempt our Lord Jesus Christ here in the book of Matthew 4. He brought his temptation to defeat him here and then. He also, Jesus Christ, defeated him. And children of Jesus will also defeat him.
Amen.
Jesus overcame by the power of the word. Not only that he did that at that time, we are told later in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, that this same Jesus spoiled principalities and powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. He spoiled them, he made a show of them. You know those athletes? After they've won, defeated their opponent, and then they carried the trophy. They raised it up for the whole world to see, I have overcome. And Jesus made a show of them openly. And finally, on the cross at Calvary, we see how Jesus fulfilled scripture. Genesis 3:15. He bruised the head of the devil. In your life, the head of the devil will be crushed.
Amen.
The Lord has promised us that he was going to reward all those who will go through temptations patiently and will overcome it permanently.
Amen.
The reward is coming. That is a crowning day for all those who will fight manfully onward. You know what our songwriters says? That's song number 6. Yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. That God is able to help you so that you will win others when you fight manfully onward and you overcome. Your life, your testimony will assist, will help somebody who is weak in faith. That if sister so and so can overcome, then I can overcome. If brother so and so can win that serious battle, then I can be a winner. And that's why we need to fight. There is something to overcome in this world. There is a fight to fight. There is a race to be run. There is something to overcome. And what Apostle Paul said to Timothy, he told him, fight the good fight of faith. And lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. That's 1 Timothy 6, verse 12. There is something to conquer. There is something to overcome. There is something that we need to wrestle against in this world. What is temptation? The best way I could define temptation is to ask you to write it down vertically. And I look at the word T of temptation. It is a test of believers' faith. Temptation tests your faith, how strong you are. And Job said, when thou strike me, I shall come forth as gold. I shall be overcome. I shall win the battle. E of temptation. Temptation is enticement from Satan for man to do evil. It is Satan's enticement. He is only enticing you to yield and do evil. M of temptation. Temptation is its means to prove our spiritual strength. It is whatever you conquer that will know you are strong. When the battle day has not come, a man may boast, I am so and so, I can do such and such. Wait a little bit. The day you are tempted and you conquer, that's the day we know your strength. Then we have P of temptation. Temptation is brought of the devil to make the upright fall. The devil wants you to fall from grace. He wants you to lose the crown of life. Temptation is brought of the devil to make the upright fall. Another T of temptation, targeting precious souls to destroy. He is targeting, as he targeted David, as he targeted Samson. He is targeting precious souls that he might destroy them. He has no other intention. For the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. John 10:10. Temptation. A is adversary's trap. Adversary's trap to set to catch a prey. Adversary's trap that is set to catch a prey, but you will not be a prey.
Amen.
The trap that Satan has set for this evening, you will not enter into it.
Amen.
It's a trap. Adversary's trap set to catch a prey. Then we have another T there. Trials. That is common to everyone in life. No one is insulated, exonerated. He even came to the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Temptations came to Paul. Temptation came to David. It is common in life. And then we have I. Temptation is information. It's just information that signal the approach of danger for us to beware. It's just information. Temptation is not a sin at all, but it is giving you information. Danger is coming. Beware. Get prepared. It is information that signal the approach of danger for us to beware. And is opportunity, always sought by Satan to destroy the faithful. Opportunity. Satan is always seeking that opportunity. It is opportunity always sought by Satan to destroy the faithful. But he will not destroy you.
Amen.
He will not destroy you.
Amen.
Tell yourself, he will not destroy me.
He will not destroy me.
Any of temptation, the last letter, it is necessary teacher. Temptation is a necessary teacher to give us experience and make us stronger. You know, that's why we sang, each trial will make you stronger. He's just a teacher, is to give us experience. And the way Romans 5:3-5 concluded it is that we glory in tribulation, in temptations, in trials, because it worketh experience, and experience hope. It gives us experience and to make us stronger. You know what? I pray for this morning. Let me read that scripture to you, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Verse 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, read it here in verse 13. It says in verse 13, but 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Yes, let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 10 first. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Chapter 10, verse 13. There has no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. God is faithful, who will not suffer, who will not allow you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. What are temptation? Whatever troubles, whatever trials come your way, the Bible says God is able. He will even make a way for you to overcome it, to overpower it, and to escape it. And so shall it be in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Temptation is what we are addressing this morning, and victory over it. And I know you'll be victorious.
Amen.
Let me quickly tell you three things to talk about. Number one, the challenge we all face. The challenge we all face. Everyone is facing this challenge. It's not peculiar to you. It's not peculiar to me. Everyone has a price to pay. The challenge we all face. Number two, the consequence of yielding and falling. The consequence of yielding and falling. And lastly, we consider the coronation of overcomers and the faithful. the crowning, the coronation of overcomers and the faithful. That is where you belong.
Amen.
That is where you belong.
Amen.
Let me look at the challenge we all face. In Luke chapter 22, I read verse 31. Luke chapter 22, verse 31. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, two times. Behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee. The Lord is praying for somebody this morning.
Amen.
I pray for thee that I fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. In verse 40. In verse 40, and when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. And that's why we pray, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. Temptation in the house, temptation on the road, temptation inside party, temptation inside the church. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. Temptation is evil. And the Lord Jesus Christ said, there is need for you to pray that God might deliver you. I might not lead you to temptation. And when peradventure, the tempter is at the door trying to lead you, may the angel of God come around and deliver you.
Amen.
When Jesus was talking to Peter here, Peter was very confident. It can't happen. I know myself. I'm a Christian. I did quiet time this morning. In fact, I just finished 7 days fasting and prayer. Do you know, Jesus went to 40 days fasting and prayer. He was strong in the spirit. And yet, as soon as he was coming out of that, Satan came and said, look at it, you're hungry, isn't it? Your appetite now has increased 40 times more. Do you remember, 40 days ago you took food, no water. You know, you are weak now, dehydration has come. No carbohydrate, no vitamin in your body. You need to eat. Turn this stone to become bread. I know you have the power. Are you not the Son of God? And if Jesus had yielded to that, all of us have failures. That is no Christianity. Because so will you yield yourself to be the servant of him you are? And Satan knows if he will succeed in making Jesus to obey his instruction, that means Jesus has become a servant to the devil. And if the green trees are falling off, what will happen to the dry ones? The road angels fear to tread. Who are you, the Son of Man, to say, man, I know myself. And can you see a cockroach that is boasting on the expressway when trailer is coming? May God deliver you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We read the book of Joshua. Chapter 7. Joshua chapter 7. And I read verse 21. Joshua chapter 7. This man was one of the soldiers that God depended upon to fight the battle of the Lord. He was a trained military man. He had been in the army of Israel. And Joshua was the captain. Joshua never knew defeat in battle. It was a replica of David. But little things that matter. Look at it. In Joshua chapter 7, here in verse 21, and the man said, when I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. Then I coveted them. Seeing it is not a problem. That is God's temptation. But it went further. I coveted them. That is still temptation. But look at the next word. And took them. You will not take what will poison you.
Amen.
What will send you to hellfire, may God not allow you to grab it.
Amen.
He said, I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran to the tent. And behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. And they took them, and walked out of the midst of the tent, and brought them unto Joshua, and unto the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all he had is contaminated already. Is already polluted. He is already an enigma. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor, valley of destruction. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? And the Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. And they raised over him a great heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger, wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day. God became furious for the children of Israel, and defeated to the whole camp because of one man. Because of one man who yielded to temptation. Who succumbed to the dancing of the devil? Who made the music of his enemy his blood tonic? Achan did not spend that money. That clothes, he never wore it. He coveted it. He took it. And problem came upon him and his entire family. Everything that Achan got, the one he got by honesty and the one he got by dishonesty. The labor of his life, every property he ever got, genuinely and in falsehood, everything was burnt. He himself was stolen. He did not die a natural death. Temptation. 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 I want to show you what the Bible says in Genesis chapter 39. In Genesis chapter 39, I want to read, let me just read from verse 12. I mean from verse 6 to 12. Genesis 39 from verse 6. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught he had saved the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well favored. That man was beautiful inside and outside, an Adonis of mankind. But something happened, and it came to pass after these things, that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, lie with me. Temptation. Madame is coming. And Madame needs to enjoy life. Madame needs young blood to make her life pleasurable. And he came and said, lie with me. You are good looking. You have a future. And he was targeting the future, the crown of Joseph, the future of Joseph, the devil knows and he sees your star ahead and does not want to get that star, but you will get it.
Amen.
And the woman said, there is nothing we can do now, you have to lie with me. And we were told, verse 8, that he refused. That's how he will refuse.
Amen.
He must say to his master, so I behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in this house. And he has committed all that he had into my hand. There is no greater in this house than I. Neither has he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? That man took his stand. He had integrity. He had self-control. He had self-discipline. He had a future to protect. He was a man of high moral probity. When a recommendation is given about you, and somebody will use that word, it satisfies any employer that man is a man of high moral probity. You can trust him. You can rely upon him. You can commit something to his hands and go and sleep. The employer is looking for that message before they give you a good job in the bank. And Joseph refused. And he said, there is nothing I can do on this matter. I can't do this great wickedness. Immorality is great wickedness, brother. I don't care what social media is saying about it. I don't care what misleading pastors are saying about it. I don't care what is written in the newspapers. I don't care what you watch in your movies. Fornication is great wickedness before God Almighty and before sensible mankind. People may promote it. They may distribute condom to you and say, go and try. This is God's word. Joseph said, this is great wickedness, and I cannot do it. Every wickedness you have done, the Lord will pardon today and tell you, go and sin no more.
Amen.
And it came to pass. It came to pass, verse 10, as she spake to Joseph day by day. The devil doesn't give up easily. He came to Jesus one time, and Jesus defeated him. He came second time, that's in Matthew 4. Jesus defeated him. He still came back the third time, stubborn devil. And Jesus now gave him knockout. Alright? Knockout. I would say a boxer who says, I don't want to waste my time in this fight. And from round one, he gives that man knockout, and the man cannot rise up again. And he says, I'm standing here, get up! And the man cannot get up. And then they blow the whistle. You will give Satan knockout in your life. So then, what happened? The woman was coming every day, enticing Joseph. Maybe making his food to be sweeter than that of Potiphar. And then she would make sure when Joseph was around, she would dress in a way that Joseph would be lured and enticed. Joseph will quickly look away. Joseph will say, you know this my neck, the way God made it, it can turn. It's not stiff. When your own is stiff, you need to go to hospital. Joseph knows my neck can turn when the evil is coming. Instead of me gazing and gazing and gazing, and the thing becomes lost. You know what we read this morning in our text? He said, when lust has conceived, it brings us sin, and sin will bring death. Let no man say when he's tempted that I'm tempted of God. God does not tempt any man with evil. Because sin itself cannot be tempted. But when you yield to temptation, it is your loss. You are interested naturally. There was willingness in you. There was connivance, agreement, concord. And then you begin to look and look and look and look until your back is on the floor. Satan will not defeat you.
Amen.
So the woman was coming every day. We're told in verse 10, and it came to pass as she spake to Joseph day by day, that he came not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went to the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house there with him. Potiphar had gone to do his activities, taking care of state work, busy in administration. And Madame said, this is a good opportunity. And maybe as she had commanded all the young men in the house, you go to this place and make sure you play very well. Young boy, you go to that place, go to the field and go and play football till evening, don't come back. Send them away so as to have a way. Satan will not have his way over your life.
Yeah.
And Joseph was alone. And she didn't send Joseph out. No. That was a motive. And now came back. And it came to pass when about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men. And verse 12, she caught him by his garment. Thank God, it was my garment you can carry, you cannot carry my soul. Thank God, it was the garment of Joseph that fell to his hands, not the body of Joseph. She caught him by his garment and said, lie with me. And he left his garment in his hand and fled and got him out. You will flee.
Amen.
If you have been falling from this time, you will flee.
Amen.
The Lord will give you grace and courage to flee.
Amen.
Flee fornication. That's what he says. Flee fornication. Flee sin. Flee evil. And I ask you these questions. Why was it that Samson's armies were removed? Not one, both of them. Permanent blindness. Alright? The devil has no mercy. He will not say, let me just make him partially blind. It was total removal. I didn't remove it in the operation theater. He removed it, got the power, pulled it out. Let the man bleed to death. Let's take the glory of his life away. Why did he die prematurely? I was a great man of God. The anointing was flowing like that of Aaron. And yet, the man became a slave in the hands of his enemies. Temptation. Because I have found the woman of sorry. I have found the lilac. Get her for me for a wife. I pray those of you who come here to study and are deviating from your study and you are going into the other part of, you know, life. What will come to you on the platter of ease later? That you will eat that food until you are fed up. You feed on it and feed on it until you are fed up. That's what you concentrate on now. You are reserving your suffering. You want to enjoy now, you are going to suffer later. But it will not happen to you.
Amen.
If you put your cart before the horse, you might destroy your future. Joseph will never have reached that destiny that God has planned for him if he had failed at this time. And if you faint in the day of your adversity, your strength is small. And this gentleman, he refused. And when the woman wanted to grab him, oh, my clothes, and ran away. Why is it, I want to ask you, that Esau lost his birthright? He was number one, and the blessings of the firstborn naturally, automatically, scripturally belonged to the firstborn, and this was Esau. He came out first, red spotted. But temptation, and he came from the field and right from afar. The thing was tantalizing in the kitchen. Jacob had prepared his food and he put enough onion, cucumber, garbage, everything was there. And the whole thing was, you know, was going into the nursery of Esau. And the hunger came 10 times more. And the man lost his control. It is either food or I die. Jacob said, that's right. I give you. You know, the devil is watching you at the point of your weakness. And that's the area he wants to catch you. He knows you are weak in that particular area. And he's looking for that. He will give you enough so as to put your back on the ground. But he will not catch you.
Amen.
And Jacob gave him food. And the devil told him, we have to enter into agreement. Bargain. Bargain with your soul. Bargain with your future. Bargain with your life. Bargain with your crown. Number one will become number two as from today. Do you agree? Esau said, you are talking grammar. Well, what will my mother do to me? Give me food. He collected food. He ate food. That is just temporal. Eternal life was taken away. The future was taken away. The Bible says when this man came back to his senses, he sought it carefully with tears. It was too late. There are some prayers that if you pray it until Jesus comes, it will not be answered. It's a principle of the Bible you violated, and that cannot be repaired. Irreparable loss will not happen to you.
Amen.
So, Esau lost it. Why did David, king of Israel, a great man, why did he become like a piece of bread you drop inside water in the presence of Nathan? When Nathan said, this won't happen, this won't happen. And David said, the man who did that is worthy of death. And Nathan said, good talk. What a great judge. You know the right thing. You are the man. You are the man. And he gave him the story. If there was that condition in the palace of David at that time, I can see David sweating and shaking before a prophet was supposed to be doing years after him. He had messed himself up with the wife of another man. And the glory just departed right there. Akabo was written on the face of David because he yielded to them. He saw just like Achan, but he could not, his neck became stiff. He kept on looking and looking and looking and looking, and until what he was looking at developed something, and information started being decoded in his brain right away, and the information circulated right all over. His nervous system became distorted. And this man, he did not only see that temptation, he went and took action. Temptation is not sin, but yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. So what do we find? Temptation and sin have been a great challenge to all believers in every generation. And yet, the consequence of falling into temptation could be terrible. The believer falls into temptation does not only willingly surrender, volitionally surrender himself to the tempter. His action will affect other people negatively. Paul had to admonish Timothy, 2 Timothy 2:3, that he should, you know, endure hardness. It's a good soldier of Christ. The devil has used simple things to tempt believers. Food is a tempter. He has used other things, complicated things, money, to tempt people. You have no money at this time. A very strong child of God, a sister that I know very well, before she became a believer, she was really living like a prostitute. Like a prostitute. And she had so many of those men. On this day, the sister was in need of money. Because after she had become a child of God, she boycotted all of them. Closed the door permanently. Go and sin no more. The blood of Jesus washed her. She became a child of God. And she was living the life of Christ. But something happened. After she became a Christian, the source of money stopped. Those days she would stay in her house and just a telephone call, money would flow in from every direction. Because she was a generous donor. Hello? She was a generous donor. But after all that, she became washed in the blood of Jesus. And the word of God says, your sins and your iniquities will I remember no more. God forgave her. She started living a Christian life. But on this day, there was no money. So she was to go from one place to the other. And this happened in Nigeria. And the sister was standing by the roadside, and the sun was bright. The thing was hitting her head seriously. And then not long, one of her old customers, a university professor, was driving his jeep and saw the sister there standing by the road. And the man parked and wiped down the glass. Mrs. Jesus, good afternoon. Where are you going? The sister did not talk. This is what you are missing now. If you are still with me, you know those days you just call me from my house. No matter where I was, I'll come and pick you and carry you to your destination. See where you are now. Can you call me and let me give you a lead? The sister stood there. She did not talk. She did not listen to him. All right. The man opened his purse and was displaying money. This is money. Good money. Will you come in and take this money? The sister stayed there. Eventually, when the man tried and tried and tried and failed, he drove away. As Satan tried on Jesus, and Jesus did not yield, he left him. And he just came and ministered to him. It is better to suffer than to die in condemnation. She overcame, you will overcome.
Amen.
When you yield to temptation and you fall, you make others to become affected. He uses opposite sex a lot. That's his tool in the hands of the devil. He uses power to tempt people. Things of this world, property, material things, he can also use intellect. This one knows better than me. Let him come and teach me histology. Alright? And very soon, histology. Whatever will make you to miss it, God will not allow you to win. Better be a failure in that course. And let us go back to God. And all of us pray and fast. You go back to that course and you score 98. We have a responsibility. A veritable tool in Satan's hand again these days is what you call social media. Are you sleeping?
No, sir.
These days, delicate days, dangerous days. You know, this phone in your hand will be for good and also be for evil. Satan has hijacked it and used it to send it to hellfire. But your phone will not send it to fire.
Amen.
You know what I find? The devil does not just jump on people suddenly. It goes gradually, step by step, until a sin that has captured his prey. It comes little by little. It starts with little, you know, text messages, communication on media. And then very soon, we begin to, you know, talk together, calling one another. Very soon, holding of hands. Very soon, hugging oneself. Very soon, it is now kissing and caressing. Very soon, you go and do the impossible. Look at the way the devil gradually came to the Lord Jesus Christ. Starting with food. Now promising him the things of this world. Now promising him to fall down and bow down and worship him. The devil comes gradually. They start into battle. A little cup of alcohol. Little by little, then you become a drunkard. Our resistance against temptation will bring persecution to us and against us, like that of Joseph. You will be persecuted, but the Lord always stands by those who are persecuted. The three Hebrew children, they suffered. They threatened them. They entered into the fire of Nebuchadnezzar. But they overcame at last. You will overcome.
Amen.
The Lord will always make a way for us to overcome temptation. And the grace of God is available for anyone who wants to be a victor. And you will be one of them.
Amen.
The consequence of yielding and falling. I will read to you a few verses of scripture. In Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5, I read verse 12. Romans chapter 5, verse number 12. Wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Adam, that little disobedience of that day, when the tempter came and spoke to Eve, and Eve began to communicate with her enemy, not knowing that Satan is subtle, is older in the business of temptation and destruction of life. And the Bible says, be wise as serpent, harmless as dove. The children of this world are wiser than their generation and the children of light. Who does go where the sheep of the Lord, and the sheep does not know the subtlety and the craftiness of the enemy. And Satan subtly creeping to destroy lives. And Eve yielded to that temptation. And then made Adam to yield. Eventually, the descendants of Adam, you and I, were suffering it today. Because somebody did not take his stand. That's why when there is temptation and yielding to it, it has multiplier effect. It may affect generations to come. It may affect your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren until any generation. Because somebody missed it. See what happened to Adam. His family did not escape. That's why we are talking. Consequence of it. Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 4 says, the soul that sinneth, he shall die. And Romans chapter 6 verse 23 says, the wages of sin is death. Everything has repercussion, result, consequence, reward. Wages of sin is death. And Exodus 32 verse 33, that's where Moses prayed unto God when the children of Israel have sinned and said, God, if you will not answer me this prayer and forgive them. Blot out my name from your book. And God told him, no, sir. It is him that sinneth against me. His name will I blot out of that book. Let me read Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Here in verse 15, looking diligently, lest any man fall of the grace of God, fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Verse 16, let there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau. You see, that's the adjective now you can use to describe Esau. Profane. Profanity had entered into his life. Who, for one morsel of meat, what did he do? Sold his birthright. For he knew how that afterward, when he will have inherited the blessing, what happened to him? He was rejected. I pray you will not be a rejected man.
Amen.
God will not reject you.
Amen.
He was rejected. For he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. A young sister, vibrant and holy. Two things you knew about this sister. Holiness, evangelism. She was hot for Jesus, not the kind of hot that you write in Facebook. When they say you are hot, they are telling you you are a child of the devil. They are telling you you are of this world. And when you are of this world, you go with the world. And they are telling you when they see your dress in the $25 dress that you bought at somewhere, and then you put it on. And you put all the, you paint all the eyes and paint all the leaves. They say you are hot. And you are happy. They say thank you. They are telling you, you do not belong to Jesus, you belong to the other world. But this other sister, she was hot for Jesus in evangelism, in holiness, rejecting sin. That's how she's been living her life. And somebody was targeting her life. Sister Jesus, sister mother of Jesus, we will see what happened. The sister went on vacation one time after school. She was a university student. And this young man did everything possible. And finally, the sister yielded to sin. And they did what was not supposed to be done. She was a virgin. And she became so condemned, and she was in that remorseful condition that holiday was getting over at that time. And she said, God, I know I disappointed you. When I get back to school, I will go to the chapel, to the school chapel. I will stay there until I have assurance that you are forgiving me. I will pray and pray so. She made up her mind that this has happened, it has happened. She packed her boat and traveled to school. Unfortunately, she did not get to school. Accident happened on the way, and from there, she went to eternity. Hello? She went to eternity. The sister died without full repentance. And somebody will say, I will pray. And God is good, I will pray. And then we come to a corner. Jesus saying, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. And you are going back to it. You are not forgiven. Right? The sin of fornication has repercussion. Even when Peter denied the Lord, Jesus said, Satan has desired to have you, to seat you as wheat. And Peter said, Jesus, I cannot deny you. But after you deny the Lord, deny the Lord, it's not fornication. He did not go to drunkenness. He did not steal anybody's property. The Bible says he went out and wept bitterly. I don't know how long, I don't know how many hours, I don't know how many days that he wept bitterly. That is remorse. That is repentance. That is conviction of sin that leads to repentance. And God will forgive. And John said, bring forth fruit, need for repentance. Let us see the evidence of your repentance. Esau, he did not find the place of repentance. She missed it forever. We will suffer, but God has the way out. So see what happened now. There is nothing we do that has no result. That's why Apostle Paul says, abstain from every appearance of sin. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. Abstain. This thing only appears to be a sin. Abstain from it. And I'm going to tell you a story before I pray. Abstain from every appearance. Don't just wait until it is labeled evil. When Satan is at hand, abstain from it. Stay clear. Satan will not take advantage of your life. You know, watch against falling into sin. You know what sin does? Sin, number one, it will sink the link of fellowship between the sinner and God. It will sink that relationship. It will no longer exist, as it did to Adam and Eve. Even when God came later to have fellowship, usual fellowship with Adam and Eve, you know what? The fellowship was broken. Fear had come to the life of Adam, and he was in a hiding. Sin to sink that relationship. Number two, sin will stop God's favor and protection from flowing to our lives. It will stop it. God's favor and protection from flowing unto us. And you see, sin. That's why Romans 6:1, shall we continue in sin that grace be abound? And what's the answer? It's not possible. The favor is gone. The protection is not there. That's why a preacher is crying out of sleep because oppression of the devil has come. That's why somebody who is a church worker, every time the devil comes, torments you with all kinds of evil spirits, evil thoughts. He that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. The wicked one cannot touch the holy sister, the holy brother. He will tempt, but he will overcome. Sin, number three, will suspend the fellowship, the link of fellowship with other true believers. It will suspend it. You know what happened in the Church of Corinth? In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, we read verses 9. Read from verse 5 to verse 11. You'll find what happened there. Somebody, a member of the fellowship, had gone into fornication. Terrible sin, and it's still powerful. When Apostle Paul came, he said, what are you people talking about? When people gather together, he said, hand over that person to Satan for the destruction of his flesh, so that his soul can be saved in the day of the Lord. He said, I warn you, keep no company with fornicators. Don't keep company with them. Even when Father so was, when he said, that if they call somebody a brother, a fornicator, we sin not to eat. Don't even eat food. Don't even share biscuits with him. When you hear that this brother is a fornicator, it's as serious as that brother. When somebody has gone into the sin of fornication, don't make him your friend. The way he will pollute you. And teach you the styles, and teach you the substance, and teach you the secrets, and it will make you to be like him. He says, don't keep company with him. You will obey the Bible. Yeah. You know, number four, sin will sieve away God's blessings. Seed it. Just like you seed a shard from a substance. Number five, sin will subdue us before the enemy of our soul. It will make us to be subdued. You know what the Bible says about Israel? In Hosea chapter 8, verse 3, it said, Israel has cast off the thing that is good, the enemy shall pursue him. That's throwing away sanity, his salvation. The enemy shall pursue him. Number six, sin will signal. Sin will signal in demons and wicked spirits. They will give the signal. And number seven, sin will seal the fate of man in hellfire. Seal the fate. This, you are qualified for that place. Not you. It will not happen to anybody here. Because Psalm 9, verse 7, verse 17 says, the wicked shall be turned to hell, and all those that forget God. Now, you know what the Bible says? Proverbs chapter 1, verse 10. My son, my daughter, if sinners entice thee, consent not, consent thou not. Don't listen to them, don't follow them. If your flesh also entices you, I say, go ahead. And when temptation comes to bring man to fall, you know what's happened? Most times, there are battles going on immediately. The Holy Ghost will come and say, my daughter, remember the scripture. My son, remember the message you have. My son, remember this thing has made many people to fall, to backslid, and they become children of the devil. My son, the Holy Ghost will be talking to you, but he's a very silent talker. And then there is another voice, the other side, that will say, go ahead. There is nothing there. Everybody is doing it. Everyone is involved in it. Even there are some church members also, even your own church. And then that one is talking to you quickly. That's what happened in Genesis chapter 3 when he came. And the Holy Ghost must have been reminding Eve. God said, thou shalt not eat of that one. As Satan said, God does not mean it. He is only saying that the day you eat it, you become civilized, your eyes will be opened. He twisted the scripture. Two battles. I want to ask you a question. If Satan and the Holy Spirit come to fight and to battle over your life, who should win? He fell on that day. You know when I remember the very pathetic story that I read? I don't know where it happened, but I read it. Brother John and Sister Joy. The two of them are choristers in the church. And they had just finished choir practice and going home. And then Sister Joy was to go home through a long, lonely, solitary road. So as usual, after choir practice, they called Brother John to please assist her, escort her. And they went together on that day, not knowing that temptation was lying at the door. And along the way, when they got to a very dark, solitary place, Brother John told Sister Joy, remember what I've been telling you all this while, pressurizing you, that should be my dear friend. I love you. And Sister Joy said, we are workers in the church. This is wickedness. This is sin against God. We should not be talking about this thing. If you're not ready to follow me, please go back and let me go alone. And she was going. And Brother John ran ahead of him, our father, and then stood in front and said, and held her right hand. Sister John, I said, I love you. And before you know what was happening, that the woman close to herself, to himself, and said, you are the one I want to marry. You will be my girlfriend. I love you. Without you, my life is not complete. And began to talk. And putting his hand on the shoulder of the sister, pressurized her until the sister was overpowered with the emotional talk. And that job was handsome. And very gifted in music. And what do you see? At the end of the day, kissing started. At the end of the day, they went to an uncompleted building when they did what they were not supposed to have done. But that's not the end of the story, sister. As soon as they finished, guilt and condemnation entered into Sister Joy, she began to cry. God has disappointed you. God, what is happening with my life? And she was trying to clean up herself because of blood. Then he saw that Radon had gotten up quickly, adjusting his adjusting his clothes. And he was laughing. He was laughing uncontrollably. And Sister Joy said, what's going on with you? Did you know what we have done? We've sinned against God. When we are supposed to be crying for mercy, and you are laughing, they Radon laughed and laughed and laughed and laughed. In the midst of the laughter, what did they see? Two personalities appeared by them right there. They were demons. They appeared right there. And when they are with horns on their head in the night. And Sister Joy was still struggling, and when she saw that, she jumped up quickly. She was so terrified. And lo and behold, Brother John had joined them. And he also had become a demon right there. And Brother John said, Sister Joy, thank you very much for cooperating with us. Now for a long time we have been looking for you. And when the demons spoke, we didn't know. We thought it would be too difficult to catch. We didn't know you can fall so cheaply for us. Now we caught you. And Radon said, I will see how you will climb the altar tomorrow to sing that your song. Your destiny as a chorister, as a music woman, where is it now? In regret, the woman was sobbing there. Joy was sobbing, her life was gone. And what happened later? The demons, the three of them, together with John, began to make jest of her spirituality. They ridiculed her life. And at the end, what happened? Sister Joy was struck with madness. For 3 years, she was going about with madness. People prayed and prayed. It was only after 3 years that the pastors were able to deliver her. It was after deliverance that she now was able to tell the story of what led to her madness. Sometimes we come and say, it doesn't matter. It's a small piece. It's just a small hug. And it's just touching my body. And it's just asking me to sit down on his lap. Little foxes destroy their lives. That's how many people have lost their precious fragility and are not useless in the hands of the men. That's how many men have been torn by peace, by little indiscretion, immorality. A good man is torn to a piece of bread. See how a manager is being slapped in the hotel in the hands of a young teenager. God Almighty watches over us in whatever we do. And everyone will pay a price for his life. You'll be accountable for yourself if you yield to temptation. Let me just summarize the last part, which is the most important to you and to me. The crowning day is ahead. The day of coronation is not far. And what Apostle Paul said is here in 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 5. Let me just read it from verse 7 for time. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. And Paul said, I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love is appearing. That is a crown for those who overcome temptations. And this crown, the Lord will help you to keep you all.
Amen.
It is refreshing to know that there are crowns and great rewards awaiting believers in heaven after they have endured trials and temptations in this world. God is not unrighteous to forget all our sufferings, our endurance, and the pains we go through. And he has promised adequate reward for everyone that is able to overcome temptation and come out shining as gold. God is able. God is able. Let me hear you say, God is able. He's able to keep you. So he that is able to keep you from falling, God is able. And we'll see what the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, I read verse 5. Revelation chapter 3, in verse 5. The Bible says here in verse 5 again, he that overcometh the sea shall be clothed in white raiment. White raiment, righteousness of the saints. Verse 12. In verse 12, he says, he that overcometh, when I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, Jerusalem, which is the Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. Verse 21. In verse 21, to him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. Overcomers, there are crowns waiting for you. Revelation chapter 2, I read verse 26. In verse 26, Revelation chapter 2, it says, and he that overcometh and keepeth my words unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. Overcomers. What are the overcomers here now today? Satan is going about looking for praise to catch. But where are the overcomers today? Satan, the Bible says, as a roaring lion is moving about seeking whom to devour. Who are the overcomers today? Satan is going about, is looking for precious souls to destroy, to devour. Who are the overcomers today? Many people have yielded to temptation. How are the mighty falling? How are the mighty falling? And David, all the story of his life, all his exploits, all his victories in battle, he brought down Goliath that nobody in the whole land of Israel can face. He brought him down. But a woman brought him down. A woman brought David down. Where will you be when the trumpet shall sound? Where will you be when it sounds so loud to wake up to death? Many are falling. How are the mighty falling? Housewomen are falling to young boys. Great men are falling to young women. Where will you be? Will you miss your crown? Or will you get your crown? Rest upon your feet and pray. Where are the overcomers today? What are those that have a covenant with God? With God to say, Lord, I want to overcome. Where have you messed up yourself up? Where have you missed it? Where have you missed it? Are you praying this afternoon? Are you praying this afternoon? See how much we have disgraced and disappointed our God. See how much we have crucified the Lord Jesus Christ once again, nailing him to the cross because of our habits, activities, indiscretion. Because we cannot control his flesh. His flesh. His flesh. If you faint in the day of your adversity, is able. Here we are this afternoon. Here we are this afternoon. When the mercy of the Lord is still flowing from Calvary, where Jesus Christ is still stretching out his hands of mercy, saying, I will have mercy. Saying, I will pardon you and warn you. Go and sin no more. Go and sanitize your life.